Hey everyone, welcome to the podcast. I am Prasanna Naidu.
And I am Rahul Devgar.
And today we are going to talk about the G7 summit. So G7 comprises of US, UK, France, Germany, Italy, Canada and Japan. And it has invited India along with Australia, South Korea and South Africa as guest countries for the summit. So let's start with what is going to happen in this summit. Like, what usually happens in G7 summits, Rahul sir?
Usually it is different because this is COVID time. So naturally coronavirus and their pandemic response will be dominant this year. But in general, the most important geopolitical situations and trade situations are the likely discussion points in G7. So once you have some sort of an agreement between G7, and actually G7 is the wrong mechanism. The G7 earlier, okay, used to have Soviet Russia. That is the, you know, earlier times. And it was sort of an agreement between the two major powers and the allied and the communist powers, which were sort of two spheres of influence in the world. That was the genesis, and that was the idea that there is some sort of a coherence in their worldview. So it was also a forum to diffuse tensions between any tensions or any sort of difference of opinion between, let's say, Soviets and Soviet bloc countries and the US and US bloc countries, or NATO countries in general, we can call them. So let's say if there is something in Eastern Europe, something in, Middle East, those kinds of things would be discussed and sort of a broad-based global understanding. So that, you know, because these were two powers against each other in a Cold War with trigger-happy nuclear weapons, and it serves as a diffusion, a point where, you know, the tensions get diffused, and that's the original intent. Post 91, that is after Soviet Russia broke down, it is more of a trade and global issues sort of conference where dominant in theme is climate these days. But climate themes, trade themes and such other global issues take the forefront. So one of these agreements or mutual understandings have led to, let's say, a World Trade Organization deal where everyone has a sort of a free trade agreement, and a general global trade has increased because of some sort of an agreement developed earlier in G7 and then expanded to G20 and so on and so forth. So it was G8 till a few years back when Russia invaded Crimea, and then Russia was dropped from this group, and now it is G7. So earlier Trump insisted that G7 without India, Russia, China and some of these countries doesn't make real any sense because these are important countries.
He suggested G10 or G11.
Yeah, he was thinking of G10, G11, but before that he was, he was actually, before that he was considering China within that group. But then there was some, you know, sort of a disagreement between him and his view on China. So he said, you know, maybe aside from China, I mean, everyone else can cooperate. The another important aspect is, some sort of a coherent global action where it is required. And these are the top countries. So there is this group of G7, an expanded group of G20. Then there is OECD group, which is developed countries put together in one group, basically. And these are the three, you can say, most influential groups in geopolitics, because the economic activity, the weight of these countries in the economic activity, global economic activity, is very high. So if they say something and they are agreeing with that, then you will find that the whole there is coordination and the action usually take place. 80% of the thing is done then. Then what remains is basically small countries, and those can be sort of influenced. So G7 with India and others part, then including like G20 and OECD, these are very important global events. Because mostly in UN, what happens is that there is not much that goes on in UN, because there's so much diversity and there is no coordination. So these groups like G7, G20, OECD, they help in coordination amongst certain countries. So that's the original intent. In this COVID times, basically COVID is one of the main issues that will be dealt with, that is COVID response, I mean, vaccines and all that. Another important thing is climate change, because we are sort of arriving at some sort of a tipping point in terms of climate change. Now,
Biden has kept that in his, you know, even in during elections and all, he has kept that as a agenda for his term, I think.
Yes, and Biden has been advocating for climate change and investments around climate change. Though there is a lot of misplaced, I mean, climate change is not well understood even today. There is a lot of...
would be the case always, because there will be people who will be saying that Earth is flat.
Not like that. So, for example, you know, if you look at climate change in general, when you simply, that's what happens when, you know, these they try to make it very simplistic, these G7 or, you know, developed countries. It's not very simplistic. It's a very complicated process of poverty alleviation in the developed countries, which is also related to climate change, and it is also related to what developed countries are doing. So developed countries, what they do is they say ki our per capita carbon consumption is so much, we will bring it down. Their consumption is too high, okay, and their in general consumption, forget carbon consumption, in general their consumption is very high. Now, how to bring that down? Because everything has an impact. Now, what you say, ki our shoe consumption is very high. Let's say, I'm just giving a random example. Suppose the developed countries have high shoe consumption, but low carbon consumption. Where are the shoes being made? In developed countries, where because of the shoe production, carbon consumption is high. So, you can't isolate these kinds of things. And because, you know, shoes means leather, leather means pollution, pollution means all these kinds of things are there. Now, all put together, you have to understand and solve this problem. And in any case, let's say, so what has happened, okay, is that climate has been used as a mechanism to deny developing countries their ability to grow and become prosperous. And this is also included in the climate discussion. Now, if you say, if you just say one point, okay, when the one point that is given to everyone in the world, that climate change should be, you know, environment should be clean. No one in this world in his sane mind will disagree with that. Yes, environment should be clean. We should have more trees. Nobody will disagree. But your actions don't, you know, align with what you're saying. And your actions, the way you're taking your actions, you're putting unnecessary burden on the developing countries, on the poor, who are least capable of holding that, you know. So you will not give nuclear power plants to India or China, or China will not make it, whatever it is there. You will force them to buy coal. And then you will say that you're, you know, consuming too much coal. And still, if you see, per capita electricity consumption in India is 10% or 20, I think it is 15% or 20% of US consumption per capita. So, which means if we start consuming power the same way as US consumes power, we need 5 times more power. Which means we will be burning 5 times more coal. And can we set up a nuclear plant? The minute is the sanctions. So you have a choice. Either you pollute or you can't eat.
But is coal the only option? We don't have like hydroelectric or any other option.
We have hydroelectric, but there is no water. What is the use of the hydroelectric plant? China is taking away the water, right? You know, it is actually there. It is not. So anyways, country like India, we have emphasized hugely on solar power, wind power. We are, and India is one of the countries which is doing better on climate change than it promised. Okay. So we are doing planting more trees. We are doing more on energy efficient lighting systems, energy efficient, systems in general. We are relying on solar power, wind power, and we are investing in that kind of infrastructure. But we won't be able to scale up our power consumption 5 times using this.
So the power generated by coal is more efficient, and we can generate it in more volume than comparatively to solar.
Yes, and it is much more smaller. Okay, so the footprint, if you put a field, on the whole field you plant solar cells, then you will get certain megawatt. A small coal plant can produce that many megawatt. Mm. A very small nuclear plant can produce 10 times that. But try explaining this to politicians, because nuclear is the, and you know, people, once you say, you know, actually if you see from all plus minus plus, you know, you do all the equations, turns out nuclear is the most environment friendly, lowest impact solution.
But it's more of psychology, I think, because nuclear, whenever you say the word, people have it in the mind as nuclear bomb, so they are like fearful of that, I guess. Is it? Am I correct?
People are, the thing is, you know, people always have some or the other whimsical opinion. It is the role of leaders to convince them.
Huh.
Yeah. To sort of explain both sides. Okay, this is our requirement. And, you know, one thing you must admit about Singapore. Singapore never does all these things. They explain everything. You know, this is the challenge. If we do this, we are facing this challenge. If we do that, we are facing that challenge. We believe these challenges we can manage. This we cannot. So we are doing this. It's an intelligent. अपने इधर कैसा है? राम ने बोला था कि वो करना है nuclear. ऐसा नहीं होता है. राम ने नहीं बोला था. Okay. And then you know, राम ने बोला था तो रहीम तो मानेगा नहीं. तो फिर वो तो गलत हो गया. तो अभी हम वैक्सीन नहीं लेंगे. हनुमान ने वैक्सीन लिया था. अच्छा, हनुमान ने कौन सा वैक्सीन लिया था? कब वैक्सीन लिया? नहीं, हमारे इसमें है कि हनुमान ने ऐसा वैक्सीन लिया था. अच्छा, तो इसीलिए हनुमान ने लिया था तो अभी हम नहीं ले सकते, बिकॉज़ वी आर एंटी हनुमान. अच्छा, ऑल दीज थिंग्स, हु इज क्रिएटिंग ऑल दिस? अ साइंटिफिक कल्चर हैज बीन रिप्ड अपार्ट एंड सेड कि यू नो सम फॉल्सहुड्स हैव बीन इंट्रोड्यूस्ड एंड देन पीपल आर बिकमिंग इमोशनल अबाउट इट. सो वैसे ही अभी ये न्यूक्लियर आएगा ना, सबका अभी सबका जेनेटिक मॉडिफिकेशन होगा, तुम भी यू विल बिकम समथिंग. वो हल्क पिक्चर में बताया ना कि उसको भी न्यूक्लियर रेडिएशन, तुम हल्क बन जाएगा. वो एक ग्रीन हल्क बनेगा, एक भगवा हल्क बनेगा. क्या बात कर रहे हैं, नो न्यूक्लियर प्लांट. और एक दूसरा चाहिए नहीं. तो दिस इज द लॉजिक, this is the emotional evocative thing which prevents a rational discussion on environment or any problem. But that is so, and this is not, I'm not talking about you and me. Okay, I'm not talking about this discussion happening in a remote place in Kerala where they want to set up a nuclear plant. No, I'm talking about, this is the discussion between G7 leaders. Okay. This is not, I'm not talking, let's not confuse, this is G7 we are talking about. So this is the kind, okay. And then they have like a unique way of thinking, you know, we will not give nuclear technology to this person. Achha? Because then he will become anti-US or whoever, anti-G7. And then it will not be good. So we will not, so let him pollute. So then other person says, he is cheaper, he is using lower cost, cheaper, and polluting more, and you let him be, then why am I not? So this is the natural question. So all these complications are involved. So it is not just an esoteric discussion about wellness of the planet. If it was, we would have solved it very easily. Everyone wants a nice, good planet, healthy, with lot of trees, lot of, you know, no one is disagreeing. The question is how to get it. And India has thankfully, sensibly decided ki we don't care how they are getting it. We have these five things. Okay, we have some sun. I mean, throughout the year, we have sun everywhere. We have some wind in certain parts. Okay. We have some hydro. Yes. We need nuclear. We have nuclear. Okay. And we have lots of places where trees need to be planted. Get going on that. And then once we get going, we will automatically solve most of these problems. So in India, we have increased our green cover. And this is not Modi or anything. All governments have equally participated in increasing the green cover. And some without government effort also, people have started increasing green cover. Some one fellow alone planted a whole jungle in Assam or someplace. So these kinds of things are happening. And people are, in general, this is ethos of India, that you have to sort of nourish the planet. And we can't nourish the whole world, we can nourish India. So we are planting green trees everywhere. You give us Pakistan, we'll plant, make it green there also. So yeah, we have no problem.
Our culture...
Want you to give Pakistan.
Yeah, our culture and nature goes hand in hand. It's
correct.
We can't separate it.
In next month, you will be giving milk to snakes. Okay. So, don't tell me. The integration of our culture with nature is so strong. And so, let me get this point also. It is also so misunderstood that once you will give this snake a milk, next day when you see that snake, you will kill it. Wo snake ko bhi confusion hota hai. कि बॉस ये है अपना फ्रेंड है कि नहीं है.
सेम थिंग लाइक इन गणपति यू विल वर्शिप द माउस एंड देन यू विल ब्रिंग रैट किल आफ्टर अ मंथ.
नहीं, बट यू विल, दैट इज व्हाट यू नो, यू विल नॉट वर्शिप एंड मेक इट एवरीथिंग क्लीन सो दैट माउस इज आल्सो क्लीन. ऐसा नहीं करेगा. वो डर्टी रखेगा एंड देन माउस आएगा तो तुम परेशान होगा. ओके. And then you will try to say, ki, you know, trees and all, Vata Purnima, you will go, put many threads around that tree, bloody that tree cannot grow now. And the next day you want some leaves, you will cut the branches and you will use it. This is not friendly, tree-friendly lifestyle. Tree-friendly means in all aspect tree-friendly. Not that when convenient, you will become tree-friendly, when convenient, you will cut the tree. And that doesn't mean ki, you cannot cut trees also. You can cut and plant more. नहीं तो डायरेक्ट आरे के टाइम जैसा हो जाएगा. You want one building, you can't get it because there are trees now.
And to be clear, it's not like we are against the culture. We are against the misunderstanding of the culture.
Of course, हाँ, exactly. See, culture has given us a power.
Our culture is beautiful.
Closer.
Yeah.
Exactly. And you have to understand it in holistic sense. It is not, and in our culture, you will never find ki. You will say ki in one place it is written ki trees, you cut trees. In other place you will say ki, you know, you worship trees. Aisa nahi hai. They say ki, you know, you have to
do what is needed.
Needed, yes.
Yeah.
But always nourish the planet. So that is what. Just don't take it. Take things from the planet. That's not what is advised.
Because that is the basic wisdom, that if you don't nourish the planet, you won't exist.
Exactly. So people also say ki restrictions on eating cows. Of course, restriction, because cow is a multifaceted animal. It gives you multiple benefits. You don't want to eat that. It's a whole ecosystem runs on cow. So why will you want to kill that? You say ki coconut is tree for it. Why? Because every part of the tree you can use. You can't use it without cutting it. But that means ki you will plant more. That's the idea.
Right.
We will say neem is the, you know, you should plant neem. Because neem has benefits. That's what they are, you know, it's they have been very logical. They have been pro-earth, pro-nature. And, you know, we should not mess up our own culture by bringing in elements which are, you know, haphazard, and be true to the culture. Our culture is good, and we will not need any climate change challenges, because we will be ahead of our goals if we follow our culture and, you know, be true to our values to nourish the planet. If we start doing that, we will have no problem. But in effect, we are also dealing with a lot of issues generated by actions of others. So global warming means Himalayas will not have as much water. Himalayas feed most of our rivers. So that will be a constraint. So all these things we have to, that's why we are, it's important that we have a seat at the table. And the, I think the third important part in this discussion is this yesterday, I don't know if you heard, that G7 has agreed to a minimum corporate tax. So all the countries, they are basically trying to get all the countries to have some sort of a minimum tax of 10%, 15%, 15, I think they agreed on. So now this brings out a very problematic question.
Tax on what, like?
On companies. So companies getting profits. So minimum you will impose 15%. Now all these countries have more than 15% tax on companies.
Yeah.
Okay. But there are 2-3 problems. So what has happened is Apple, very famous computer company, it creates a lot of intellectual property, but that property is owned by a company, Apple's company in Iceland. Okay. Now iPhone may have like 2500 you know, 2550, I don't know how many new patents involved and the new intellectual property created for that iPhone. These patents are held by the company in Iceland. Now to use this in every iPhone, Apple of America buys the rights to these patents from Apple of Iceland at a very hefty price. Okay, so let's say the iPhone costs $2,000 these days. Okay, or $1,000, that's for assume $1,000 iPhone. So $1,000, you will find that the cost of the the material cost of iPhone is about $200 to $300.
Okay.
And $700 is the Apple's design cost. Out of this 700, about 500 or 600 goes to Apple Iceland because of using these technologies as a cost. Okay. So Apple USA makes $200 or $100, $200 on every iPhone. And it pays US taxes on these $100, $200. Okay. So 50% agar tumne tax lagaya, if you say keep US is taxing at 50%, so at $100 which Apple is, you know, earning in US, usme all the salaries will go, everything will go, all the details will go, and then $25 or $50 will remain. On that 50%, $25 Apple will pay taxes on a $1,000 iPhone. Apple Iceland has got a special deal with Apple that they will not tax Apple. Or they will tax at some lower rate, or whatever, 10% or something. So, 700 which went to Apple Iceland, Apple will pay $70 and get away with it.
So, but this is because these governments usually charge a lot of high taxes on these companies. So, that's why they try to find ways evading these taxes, right? In India also, it's the same story.
Correct. But the thing is, so now what companies are playing? They are playing Iceland's taxes against American taxes. Okay. Hmm. Within America, they will play American Californian taxes versus Florida taxes or Delaware taxes. In India, they will say ki, you know, India mein sab jagah pe reverse situation hai, so you can't escape. So they will sit in Mauritius.
Singapore, somewhere.
No, Mauritius has got a agreement.
Achha.
Or Maldives. And then they will operate in India.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, this is the tricks that they use to make this go away. Okay. So this is called, you can call it jurisdiction shopping. Yeah. Okay. So this, to avoid this, what they are saying ki we should have similar policies. Okay. But now India wants to develop, let's say India wants our own Apple to come up. Okay. Orange. Let's say we have an Orange in India company trying to make phones. Okay. Our Orange cannot get, our Orange will also have to pay 15% taxes. Okay. So now this is becomes a problem. We want to encourage, so we have to give them extra benefit or whatever. Now I am completely against using tax as a policy tool. Okay, to encourage. I think, you know, if you want to encourage, give them money. You say, you know, in Kaitna tax, I will give them 50% of what they pay as a tax. I'll give them as a direct cash transfer. Rather than say, ki, you know, your tax may, they will have a separate column, and then, you know, tax should be simple. A fourth standard student should be able to calculate his own taxes and taxes of any company. Add, subtract, find, multiply by something, percentage, answer. Now, you are complicating it so much, and it is a matter of taxation is a matter of sovereignty.
Yeah.
This whole democracy and all this started because taxation. British were taxing Americans and not giving them anything. So Americans said no representation means no taxation. So if you want taxes, you elect our present person and then make him represent. So same thing we followed in India. No tax, no representation means no taxation. That's what we were telling the British. That's why 1935 Government of India Act was passed, which then was converted into our constitution. So this is very critical. Tax is sovereignty. You cannot impose globally. And now they are going to impose that on all countries. You also agree. And I may have a 25% tax. Doesn't matter. Just because plus it is 15%. No, not plus 15%.
Okay.
I have 20. So at least you should have 15%.
Okay.
That's what they are saying. So if you have more than that, you should not agree. But who are you to tell us?
Exactly.
I don't want anyone to tell us this is another form of colonialization. We don't want this. We are not going to agree to this. And I mean, we will, you know, have a tax rate which is 25%, but not because you want us to have 15% at least. We'll have 10% also tomorrow. You are no one to tell us. That's the whole point. And this is more a matter of principle rather than anything else.
But what does it make any difference for these countries if the tax rate is 15% or more? How does it matter to them?
See, it is not what matters to them. This is how it happens. Okay. First, they will convince 7 people. Then, if you want to do business with 7 people, they will convince 20 people, G20. Then they will convince OECD. Then they will have good amount of votes to pass it in UN. And then they will impose it on Iceland and Cayman Islands and all these places. Singapore and Hong Kong and whatever.
So then, they will tighten it.
So, and the whole point is, it is what it is. You know, in my book, and in you will find that this point I have raised in my book in 2010.
Subverting capitalism.
Yes, in that book I have written this, ki forum shopping is a problem. you are creating a regulatory arbitrage. Ki someone is giving me benefits, someone is giving me free land, someone is giving me free taxes, free employee, no employee restrictions, hire and fire. And Amazon did just that. They said in New York and some other place, who will win the Amazon headquarters? What benefits will you give us? So New York said, we'll give you $5 billion worth of benefits. Someone said, we'll give you $9 billion. And then they were forum shopping. So this is exactly what is wrong. But this is doesn't mean ki you will, you know, trample on global sovereignty and impose a certain law. You invent a mechanism saying ki if you want to do business, you have to do it in a transparent way, because then no one understands accounting. Okay, how these transfer pricing mechanisms work, they don't understand, they don't want to create, because these tax people and you know, accounting people, whenever they create regulation, they create regulation with loopholes which only they can exploit. Okay. So unless you have access to a high price tax player, you know, a consultant or these kinds of people, you will not be able to exploit that loophole. And this is going to be used as a non-tariff barrier. Now I'll tell you another thing which happened recently is that our Covaxin the Bharat Biotech had received a partnership deal with some US company, because Covaxin is having a lot of research data. So they applied for emergency approval in US. US FDA rejected that. They said you do the full approval, which takes 7 years. Okay. So you do the full, for your vaccine, you do the full approval. Now, why did they do that? They are creating non-tariff barriers so that you will, Pfizer, all these, Moderna, all these players in US will get a head start. Okay. Once a similar vaccine to Covaxin will come up in US, then they will give both the vaccines emergency approval. Let's say Johnson & Johnson vaccine may not be similar to Covaxin, but let's say assume Johnson & Johnson comes up with a vaccine which is very similar to Covaxin. Then they will give Johnson & Johnson approval, and then they will give Covaxin approval. Or they may still not give Covaxin approval. And this is weaponizing your regulation. Okay. And they are weaponizing the regulation, and then they are using this, you know, 15% tax as a global benchmark. You know, you are creating a bigger mess. Okay. Yes, we can agree to have a 15%, but you can't impose. No. This is colonialism 2.0 or 4.0, whatever you want to call it.
Right.
So this has to be resisted. I don't know how Modi will do it. He's been invited into this G7, but some of these things, and then, you know, this corona crisis, the two aspects of it. One is you hold up the essential raw materials, and then you promise us 2 million vaccines. You know how many people we have? 1,000 million. 2 million vaccines, say, what will we do? You give us the material, we'll make 100 million vaccines and give you 3 million. So, I mean, you know, ek jagah se naak dabane ka aur dusri jagah se, that's not fair. Okay. This is not, so this is what, and you know, how this regulatory arbitrage plays. Covaxin doesn't get approval because India is tightening Twitter. Could be. So we have to play these games also now. And then we are in a quad. What quad? And this is why India doesn't trust America. Okay. You are playing, you know, if it is fair, you either say ki it is rejected or it is accepted.
Right.
Okay. I mean, US FDA knows whatever data has been submitted by Bharat Biotech, it is definitely, it knows ki this is either going to go positive or negative. It knows the answer. If this vaccine works or it doesn't work.
Mm.
Okay. Mm. This all sham business of getting a prolonged trial is not actually working. You know, it is not the real deal.
Mm.
So that you know these kinds of games are what G7 plays. So essentially, G7 has been playing this game with China to gain more favors from China. But China is a master strategist, so it used that to gain more favors and then extracted the whole manufacturing. They just depleted the whole manufacturing from US and developed countries. They have no more manufacturing prowess as compared to China. The mid-tier manufacturing. See, anyway, tomorrow, let's say tomorrow you say, ki, we'll design, suppose in India, they will come up with a car manufacturer like a Ferrari. Ferrari car manufacturing will not happen in a day, because for that you need a robust normal car manufacturing. First, you will have a good, robust Maruti 800 manufacturing. Then you will have a Mercedes-Benz manufacturing level car, I'm saying, not Mercedes-Benz exactly, but that kind of a car.
Hmm.
Then you will have a super luxury sports car kind of a thing, which you can manufacture. And then you will say, ki, now I can manufacture a Ferrari. Okay. So, and it is not because you don't know. Ferrari is, it's not a difficult, mechanically, it's not a difficult thing to understand. Or the thing is, you have to have skills down the chain. Now in US, you can manufacture, you are manufacturing from small items to large items, aircraft engines on the top end of the scale spectrum. Okay. To you are manufacturing small vacuum cleaners. The principle may be similar. Okay. Fan blades, moving air. Okay. But now there is no more vacuum manufacturing. Now there is no more manufacturing which starts from vacuum cleaners and in the middle. You have directly, you are only manufacturing aircraft engines. Fine. But that whole ecosystem that is required to create new products, to create these new innovations, that is lacking. And China is developing that ecosystem at a substantial cost to their own profitability. Why are they developing? Because they want that innovation. The next generation of winter, whatever aircraft engine should come from us. And then we will sell them to the world. That's what they want. And now G7 has realized that. And now China has become too big. And China has become one of the subjects of G7. So China is threatening Taiwan. What to do with Taiwan? You are not recognizing Taiwan, because you are so beholden to China. And Taiwan is helping the world with the vaccine, it was the first to establish that human to human transmission is happening when WHO was, putting his head in sand and not listening to global evidence. Taiwan was the first to say and prove that it is human to human transmission is happening. Please wear mask. But you don't even recognize Taiwan. And it is under threat. China is flying airplanes all over the South China Sea. China is holding up supplies to, many of these green tech for, rare earths and all these things which are required for green tech, environmental impact. So China has become a main point of discussion in this G7. So G7 will have now, I think, four issues now. Vaccines, how to develop and how to sort of unshackle Indian manufacturing on vaccines. Climate change, which is a big, big problem. And then you will have China as the third main component. And I think there will be few others, which is Middle East and all these things will continue to be there.
After this G7 summit, Biden's going to for a NATO conclave on 14th June. So, and after that, he'll be having a conversation with Vladimir Putin.
Putin, yeah.
So, they'll also discuss something about Russia, like how to deal with them. Because Russia has good relation and is developing relations with China, so it's like connected, I think.
Not really that way. See what, you know, from my point, I'm more concerned about what kind of belligerence US will show under Biden. Because under Trump, they just wanted to get out of everything. Okay. Mm-hmm. They just wanted to go home. In fact, you know, they were ready to leave the places, creating a bigger problem by leaving the place. And thankfully, people convinced them, you know, don't leave Afghanistan like hanging. Otherwise, there will be a bigger ISIS crisis and you will have to come back. So, you know, handle it properly, close it properly and then leave. So, in any ways, they have left in haste. And now, I don't know, Biden has reversed that or not, but they are supposed to leave. As agreement with Taliban and whatever they have agreed. But similar mess they have created, you know, they wanted to get out of Syria and Iraq also. But they couldn't. Mm. And now, the whole point of Biden is that he is more aggressive. He is more creating tensions rather than sort of reducing tensions. And he is empowering Iran with that nuclear deal. And it is going to create a big problem in the Middle East. And to counter Iran, all these Arab countries have become friends with Israel. Can you believe that? That Trump got this done and nobody is thanking him. A Middle East which is friends with Israel. It's a fantastic thing. Now Biden is trying to drive, problems there and make Middle East unstable. At the time when oil prices are already at $70, which means they Biden and who is working? Is this the military industrial complex or what it is? And this is what Putin was against. Putin went to US. I think we discussed in one of our podcasts also. Putin went to US and in US press he told that your people are financing the people who are killing your soldiers. I don't know how America works. I can understand you killing us or something like that, he said, which is like ridiculous. And, Putin is capable of saying all these kinds of things. He's thinking, I can understand you wanting to kill Russians or you wanted to kill Syrians, but why are you financing the people who are killing American troops? I have never seen such a strategy. And if these kinds of things are happening, then we have to be watchful because US might start giving more assistance to Pakistan. Okay. And that will create another level of problem for us. Pakistan, after Balakot, Pakistan has been quiet for 2-3 years. How long do you think they will be quiet?
Hmm.
This is same thing as Israel-Palestine. After every 3-4 years, they will try to create some problem. If you get more aid into Pakistan, 99%, I'm telling you, Pakistan will create some terrorist attack in India. This is given. I'm telling you, it is like, the minute aid comes, the first thing they will do is this. They already have aid from China. And this is what we have to watch out for as an observer in G7. See, what are they doing? Hopefully some sense prevails and, overall conflict is toned down, not up. So these are the 4-5 things which is critical to watch for in G7. The global minimum tax is something that is irritating me no end, in fact. And people agreeing to it is another level of, I don't think they realize ki it is colonization because they are all colonizers group. It's all colonizers group, right? Yeah. Including Japan who was trying to colonize Korea and Southeast Asia. So all are colonizers. They don't realize ki this is a colonization strategy. And for us, it reeks of colonialism 4.0 or 5.0. I don't know which 0.0 is going on now.
Okay, so I think we have covered most of the points which we think are going to be covered in the G7 summit, which will be happening on 12th June and 13th June. Okay, so thanks for listening, guys. if you want to check out the episodes, you can listen to us on Spotify, Apple Podcast, Google Podcast, and also on YouTube. We have other videos on YouTube too. And also, if you like speak Marathi or understand Marathi, we have also launched a channel, Right Views Marathi, on which we have started uploading videos. So you can check that out too. Okay. Thanks for listening. Bye-bye.
Thank you.